7. července 2017 hlasovalo 122 zemí ve prospěch smlouvy o zákazu jaderných zbraní. Země, které nedisponují jadernými zbraněmi, ale žijí pod jejich hrozbou, hlasovaly pro jejich zákaz. Vlády světových jaderných velmocí bez vědomí většiny svých občanů pro zákaz nehlasovaly. I přesto však proces směřující k zákazu jaderných zbraní pokračoval. Stalo se tedy něco nového.
So the humanitarian initiative was really a way to challenge the mainstream security discourse that treat these as tools of international security, the language of deterrence, treating these weapons as something that prevents conflict instead of actually examining them for what they are.
The focus changed from tools of security and stability to human beings are destroyed. Nuclear weapons are catastrophic to humanity and catastrophic to life on this planet.
After all, it's the people who suffer, and this has been forgotten in our debate.
Now, we today have a massive body of evidence that a nuclear war would simply not only not be winnable, it would likely destroy life on Earth as we know it today.
I mean, basically, I think we face an incredibly dangerous situation. I think if we don't get rid of these weapons, they are going to get rid of us. And everything that we cherish, and it doesn't have to be.
It's not a practical weapon. It's basically just a big symbol. And I think that's why the treaty is so effective, because you fight symbols with other symbols.
Mezinárodní kampaň za zrušení jaderných zbraní byla zahájena lidmi, kteří jsou přesvědčeni, že jaderné zbraně způsobují nepopsatelné utrpení lidských bytostí a vytvářejí zcela nepřijatelnou humanitární katastrofu.
So we established this campaign around 2006 and we felt that the specific objective needed to be a treaty that outlawed nuclear weapons completely.
So we're about 11 years old now. And was very much inspired by the campaign to ban landmines and the Cluster Munitions Coalition.
Proces v OSN pokračuje a 50 zemí musí ratifikovat smlouvu, aby mohla vstoupit platnost. To neznamená, že by jaderné zbraně zmizely ze dne na den, ale je to začátek jejich konce.
We Hibakusha had been waiting for the ban for 72 years. Let this be the beginning of the end of nuclear weapons.
Historie jaderných zbraní je krátká. V době druhé světové války několik vědců odhalilo, že by bylo možné vyrobit nesmírně silnou bombu pomocí atomového štěpení. Německé ozbrojené síly by bývaly mohly ve svém výzkumu uspět a přijít s konečnou zbraní.
At the moment of surrender, Hitler had in the blueprint stage transoceanic rockets, which could have destroyed our city.
Americká vláda to považovala za záležitost přežití a přidělila obrovské množství prostředků na sestrojení atomové bomby. Ale v době, kdy se konal první test v poušti v Novém Mexiku a kdy miniaturní slunce oznámilo začátek jaderného věku, se již německá armáda vzdala. Rozhodnutí použít bombu na japonská města bylo přijato už v nové situaci, která se vyznačovala koncem války a rozdělením světa mezi vítězné velmoci. Během druhé světové války armády masakrovaly civilní obyvatelstvo nemilosrdným srovnáním celých měst se zemí. Toto bombardování předpovídalo jadernou hrůzu. 6. srpna 1945 byla na Hirošimu schozena uranová bomba.
At that moment I saw in the window the tremendous flash and I couldn't comprehend But before you had a chance to comprehend what was happening, I knew my body was flying up in the air. After that, I lost consciousness. Now, when I regained the consciousness in the total darkness and silence, I knew, finally, Americans got us. I couldn't move my body, so I knew I faced death. But I wasn't panic-stricken at all. Then all of a sudden, strong hand touched me from behind. Don't give up, don't give up. Keep moving, I'm trying to free you. You see the light coming from that opening and move towards it as quickly as possible. Now, I'm trying to free you. Come on, keep pushing, keep kicking. Finally, he was able to free me. Also, it happened at 8:15 in the morning. It was dark, dark like twilight. And then I began to see in the dark some moving objects. But they were so silent. They didn't look like human beings. The hair was standing up and all curled up, and skin and flesh were just falling out. Some were carrying the eyeballs in their hands, the skin and the flesh hanging. The majority of my schoolmates were working in the center part of the city. They are the first one who simply vaporized, melted. From my school, over 300 students were there. I'm alive because I wasn't there. I was somewhere else, far, 1 mile away. I was inside a building. I was buried by the collapsed building. I must have been protected. But those people had no protection directly under.
Výbuch způsobil nepopsatelné utrpení a nikdo nemohl zraněným pomoci. O 3 dny později byla schozená plutoniová bomba na Nagasaki. Kromě lidí, kteří zemřeli okamžitě, umírali další oběti na nemoci z ozáření po dlouhou dobu.
So you can imagine the situation when the ICRC, so we were our doctors and delegates happened upon the scene in Hiroshima. Out of 300 doctors present in Hiroshima, 270 had died. Out of 1700 nurses, 1600 had been killed. And out of some 140 pharmacists, 120 had been killed. So the original number of fatalities in Hiroshima and Nagasaki at the end of 1945 was 140,000 in Hiroshima and 70,000 in Nagasaki. Those figures increased between two and threefold in the next 5 years due to radiation sickness from radiation exposure.
In the first second, the white light is blinding, the heat immense. In the first day, fires consume the city and there's no way to fight them. Your skin is badly charred. In the first week, those hospitals that are still functioning are overwhelmed and can't treat the injured. Others who seem fine suddenly fall ill and die from radiation sickness. In the first year, radiation is seeped into the water and the soil. Crops and animals are contaminated. The humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapons are horrific and span generations. It's time to ban them now.
A corto plazo vamos a tener efectos por básicamente 4 cosas. La onda expansiva, te va a hacer unos vientos huracanados que destruyen todo a su paso y que convierten a todo, incluso los mismos cuerpos humanos, en proyectiles. Luego se produce una onda de calor en el orden de los millones de grados centígrados, que lo que esté más cerca o dentro de las partes más calientes de esa onda se evaporan, se vaporizan. O sea, el efecto que depende de la dosis de la radiación y el que depende solamente de la exposición a la radiación gamma. Ante una exposición bastante grande, los efectos pueden durar horas o incluso días. Hay una destrucción masiva de los órganos internos. A las dosis medianas pueden durar meses o años recuperándose de lesiones, si es que se recuperan. Y si se logran recuperar, entonces hablamos de los efectos crónicos, que sería una incidencia mucho más alta de varios tipos de cáncer, especialmente la leucemia, el cáncer de tiroides, cáncer de mama.
For example, my uncle and aunt, when we heard they survived, we rejoiced. But a week later, they started feeling so sick. They started vomiting on, and they started having purple spots all over the body. And that was a sure sign they are going to die.
La bomba nuclear produce una onda electromagnética que interrumpiría la comunicación electrónica, afectaría muchísimos aparatos de los cuales dependemos ahora actualmente, especialmente los hospitales.
And a lot of people suffered with a scar, a very bad scar. They didn't look nice. So some thoughtless people started calling them all their ghosts and so on. Social alienation, yeah. And discrimination was real. So those girls with that kind of, no, they lost the opportunity for equal treatment for anything, employment, marriage, housing, and whatnot. So it was not just the physical damage, but the social, psychological, in every way. The city just disappeared.
Po užití bomby bylo ospravedlněno jako nezbytné zlo k rychlému ukončení konfliktu. To je ovšem nyní historicky zpochybňováno.
Recent research shows that it's highly unlikely that the Japanese surrendered because of nuclear weapons. They surrendered because the Soviets came into the war. The night before we bombed Nagasaki, the Soviet Union declares war. It significantly changes our view of nuclear weapons writ large because Hiroshima was the first impression. It was the notion that set up all the subsequent thinking. And if we change how we think about Hiroshima, it changes everything.
Od té chvíle se jakákoliv velmoc, která nedisponovala jadernými zbraněmi, cítila zranitelná. V následujících letech vyvinuli Sovětský svaz, Velká Británie, Francie a Čína své vlastní atomové bomby v kontextu konfrontace mezi západními a východními bloky během období známého jako studená válka. To je také doba, kdy byla založena Organizace spojených národů ve snaze vytvořit platformu pro vyjednávání, aby se zabránilo vyostření konfliktů v ozbrojenou konfrontaci. Členské státy rovněž podepsaly chartu lidských práv. Univerzální práva nadřazená zájmům a moci jednotlivých stran. Tyto snahy však ustoupily tvrdé realitě, ve které dvě supervelmoci násilím ovládly planetu a ohrozily ji nezodpovědným závodem ve zbrojení.
The United Nations had been working to address the threat of nuclear weapons since its foundation. The very first resolution adopted by the UN General Assembly was for the total elimination of all weapons adaptable to mass destruction. And yet it took all that time to finally put in place a total ban on the weapons.
Bylo provedeno až 2000 zkoušek jaderných zbraní, a to se stále silnějšími bombami. Odhaduje se, že radiace z těchto testů zasáhla miliony lidí.
And in order to test nuclear weapons, primarily they've been tested on the lands of indigenous people. They've been tested on the lands of those without power. And that's deliberate.
So in the 1950s and 1960s, nuclear weapons were tested in Australia by the British government with the full support of the Australian government. And this has had a profound impact, particularly on the indigenous communities that live nearby. And even though the tests stopped decades ago, the consequences are still being felt today.
V Japonsku americká armáda fotografovala a měřila vše, v včetně následků radiace na lidská těla a zdraví. Nic z toho ovšem běžní lidé nevěděli. Všechny tyto informace byly cenzurovány po dlouhou dobu, včetně svědectví těch, kteří přežili.
Later on, the United States established something called ABCC, Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission, in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So people were so happy. Finally, we were going to get some medical attention, medical supply. But no, the sole purpose of those was to study the effect of radiation on human body, but not to give supply or help, medical help. When people found that out, you can imagine, they felt, oh, they are simply using us as guinea pig. And then there was quite a bit of oppression. So people were not that free. Even the press were not free to write about. And not only that, they started confiscating personal things among the survivors. Some people kept the diaries, or the pictures, photographs, slides, all kinds of, but those things were too dangerous. They were all confiscated, 32,000 items in all, and they were shipped back to Washington.
Nevěděli to ani běžní Američané, dokud několik statečných novinářů neporušilo cenzuru, aby se lidé dozvěděli o jaderné hrůze. Jaderné zbraně byly ospravedlněny jako obranné zbraně. Je to doktrína zastrašování. Jaderná bomba má nepřítele odrazovat od útoku. V případě dvou bloků studené války byla za záruku světového míru a bezpečí považována vzájemně přislíbená destrukce. Od druhé světové války nicméně několik konfliktů téměř vyústilo v jadernou válku. Nejznámější je kubánská raketová krize. Začala otevřená válka a několik poradců prezidenta Kennedyho mu poradilo, aby napadl ostrov a dokonce, aby použil jaderné zbraně. Nakonec byl v poslední chvíli učiněn krok zpět. Tento prožitý poplach vytvořil podmínky pro první dohody omezující jaderné testování.
So deterrence, the notion that nuclear weapons have kept us safe during crises is simply historically inaccurate. The nuclear believers often say deterrence has been perfect because there's been no nuclear war. It's a ludicrous argument on the face of it. In 1948, the Soviets blockaded Berlin, and it's a situation which could easily have led to nuclear war. The United States had a monopoly on nuclear weapons, but the Soviets weren't deterred. In 1950, the Chinese joined the Korean War despite the US moving nuclear weapons to Guam, and so on. You say deterrence has never failed. Clearly it has. If human beings are fallible, and if human beings are involved in nuclear deterrence, then nuclear deterrence, by definition, is inherently flawed. It will fail. It's not a question of if, it's just a question of when.
Nebezpečí úmyslného použití je znásobeno rizikem nehody. V současné době existuje 2000 jaderných zbraní připravených k okamžitému použití, které mohou být spuštěny během několika minut. V roce 1983 sovětský radarový systém nesprávně interpretoval se skupení mraků jako raketový útok.
So many stories of near misses and this Colonel Petrov from Russia, who was such a hero. He was in the missile silo and he saw something that indicated that they were being attacked by us, and he was supposed to unleash all his bombs against New York and Boston. And he waited, and it was a computer glitch. And he even got reprimanded for not following orders. It's like we're just lucky. We're living in a fantasy.
You know of at least six occasions when the world has come within minutes of nuclear war because deterrence failed, because one or the other nuclear weapons state, usually the United States or Russia, believed it was under attack and actually began the process of launching its own nuclear weapons, only to stop at the very last minute when the mistake was discovered. Six times that we know about that this has happened. This is an insanely dangerous situation.
Todas aquellas herramientas, en este caso armas, que inventamos, se acaban usando. Cuando hay una probabilidad de 1 por 1000, tú dejas pasar suficiente tiempo y se produce el hecho del 1 por 1000, ¿no?
V roce 1968 byla podepsána smlouva o nešíření jaderných zbraní drtivou většinou suverénních států. Snažila se omezit držení jaderných zbraní a zastavit jejich šíření, avšak jejich držení se nezřeklo o něch 5 států, které v té době již testy prováděly.
And 5 countries, the US, Russia, China, England and France, promised to give up their nuclear weapons if all the rest of the world wouldn't get them. And everybody signed this treaty except India, Pakistan and Israel, and they went and got their own bombs.
For about 70 years, we had sort of an international legal system that accepted that 5 countries have it. It didn't reject nuclear weapons. It did say that we should work towards disarmament, but it also kind of acknowledged that, well, these countries have them so far and they are kind of important for security for them. And that's just not it's just not good enough for law. You can't have an apartheid law that treats people differently or countries differently. You have to have the same rules for everyone, otherwise it's inconsistent and it's not going to work.
Šíření jaderných zbraní a technologický pokrok vytvářejí nová nebezpečí. Existuje možnost, že by malá skupina mohla vyrobit bombu. Také je tu nebezpečí, že by v zemi s jadernými zbraněmi mohlo dojít k vnitrostátnímu převratu či společenským nepokojům a zbraně by tak již nebyly pod bezpečnou kontrolou. Dále mohou být napadeny počítačové systémy a konečně jakýkoliv výbuch nad jadernou elektrárnou by způsobil masivní nekontrolovatelnou kontaminaci.
Millions of people would be exposed to lethal doses of radiation and tens of millions of people would be exposed to doses of radiation that would put them at increased risk for cancer should they survive the immediate post-war period. So this is an enormous problem. And one which is generally ignored completely.
I konflikt omezený na malou oblast by měl globální důsledky pro miliardy lidí.
The global consequences come from climate disruption. 100 Hiroshima-sized bombs going off over 100 cities cause 100 firestorms, and they loft about 5.5 million tons of soot into the upper atmosphere, which blocks out the sun, cools the planet, dries the planet, and as a result of this disruption of food production, this limited war would, we believe, trigger a worldwide famine that would put up to 2 billion people at risk of starvation.
V 80. letech dosáhl závod ve zbrojení svého vrcholu. Každý rok bylo vyrobeno tisíce jaderných hlavic, jejichž počet vystupoval až na 70 tisíc. Což by stačilo na několikanásobné zničení naší planety. Od počátku jaderného věku se opakovaly varování a protesty vědecké komunity a rychle se šířily na veřejnost. V listopadu 1961 se Women for Peace staly průkopnicemi, když stávkovali, veřejně demonstrovali a pochodovali proti jaderným zbraním v 60 městech po celých Spojených státech.
So women have always been at the forefront of anti-war activism. The Women's International League for Peace and Freedom was actually founded in 1915 during a war, during World War I. And it was founded by women from all over the world. Women were instrumental in the 1960s campaigning for a nuclear weapon test ban treaty, collecting baby teeth to show the effects that atmospheric nuclear testing was having on the environment and on children and on citizens.
V několika evropských zemích pacifisté organizovali pochody a protesty proti základnám jaderných zbraní. Ty největší se konaly ve Velké Británii, kde kampaň za jaderné odzbrojení organizovala od roku 1959 protestní pochody, čímž vytvořila symbol, který dodnes zůstal spojen s mírem. V roce 1982 se v New Yorku shromáždilo proti jaderným zbraním milion lidí. O rok později se v několika evropských městech konaly masivní protesty, které přivedly do ulic přibližně 3 miliony lidí.
V 80. letech nastala možnost omezené jaderné války v Evropě, kde měly obě strany enormní zásoby jaderných zbraní krátkého doletu. Vojenská cvičení vytvořila předválečné prostředí. Napětí dosáhlo vrcholu a společenské klima se často měnilo v apokalypsu.
They had a march in Kazakhstan that was led by this Kazakh poet Olza Sulaymanov, because the people in the Soviet Union were so upset in Kazakhstan. They had so much cancer and birth defects and waste in their community, and they marched and stopped nuclear testing. Gorbachev said, "Okay, we're not going to do this anymore."
En Zaragoza teníamos una base norteamericana y por tanto éramos objetivo nuclear evidente. Promovimos lo que fue la primera movilización pacifista poderosa en España, a la base norteamericana, que fueron 30 kilómetros de cadena humana, más de 30.000 personas.
A movement in Europe, in the Soviet Union, here in North America, stopped that march to war. We reversed the Cold War arms race. And I believe that we saved the world.
Ovšem nepokoje způsobené těmito obavami a společenskými protesty vytvořily podmínky pro postup smluv a účinné snížení jaderných arzenálů. Zlom nastal, když se Reagan a Gorbačov dvakrát setkali v polovině 80. let. Navzdory překážkám byla v roce 1987 podepsána smlouva o likvidaci raket středního a krátkého doletu, která ukončila euroraketovou krizi. Po tomto trendu směrem k odzbrojení na počátku 90. let následovaly smlouvy o omezování raket na dlouhé vzdálenosti. Pacifistické hnutí začalo slábnout poté, co se uvolnilo mezinárodní napětí, i když ve skutečnosti viselo jaderné nebezpečí stále nad našimi hlavami. Mezitím se rozsáhlé oblasti planety prohlásily za zóny bez jaderných zbraní. V roce 1991 se Jihoafrická republika připojila ke smlouvě o nešíření jaderných zbraní a zahájila demontáž svých 6 bomb. Ukrajina, Bělorusko a Kazachstán předali Ruské federaci jaderné zbraně, které zdědili po Sovětském svazu. Varšavská smlouva byla zrušena a studená válka na počátku 90. let skončila. Došlo k uvolnění napětí. Avšak o několik let později se situace začala znovu komplikovat. Navzdory zmizení svého původního nepřítele NATO nadále existovalo a expandovalo.
Reagan said to Gorbachev, don't worry, let East Germany be united, West Germany enter into NATO, and we promise you we will not expand NATO one inch to the east.
Zdůvodnění vojenských výdajů se obrátilo k údajnému nebezpečí od takzvaných darebáckých států. Vedly se války a okupace, což nevytvořilo vhodné podmínky, za nichž by mohly smlouvy o odzbrojení pokročit dál. Když v roce 1995 k předpokládanému odzbrojení z roku 1968 stále nedošlo, konference o přezkumu smlouvy o nešíření jaderných zbraní rozhodla tuto smlouvu prodloužit na dobu neurčitou výměnou za vytvoření zóny beze zbraní hromadného ničení na Blízkém východě, což je něco, co ještě musí být splněno. V této souvislosti došlo k prvním pokusům o vytvoření mezinárodní sítě protijaderných organizací Abolition 2000.
Then we got together and drafted our own statement. We asked for a treaty to eliminate nuclear weapons by the year 2000. We acknowledged the inextricable link between nuclear weapons and nuclear power and asked for the phasing out of nuclear power and the establishment of an international renewable energy agency.
50 let od vstupu v platnost nesplnila smlouva o nešíření jaderných zbraní svůj závazek dosáhnout odzbrojení.
The NPT commits states in Article 6 to nuclear disarmament, to effective measures towards nuclear disarmament.
Well, there's a loophole because it doesn't promise, like the chemical and biological weapons say, they're prohibited, they're illegal, they're unlawful. The NPT just said we five countries make good faith, will make good faith efforts. That's the language to eliminate, you know, for nuclear disarmament.
Ačkoliv se počet jaderných hlavic nezvyšuje, investice do modernizace arzenálu pokračují.
Se están invirtiendo miles de millones de dólares al año. Actualmente 120 mil millones de dólares al año. Estamos usando muchísima plata, la plata con la que podríamos estar librando al mundo enteramente de la hambruna, dándole educación primaria para absolutamente todo el mundo.
Climate change, poverty, inequality. We can't be wasting billions of dollars on nuclear weapons.
V současné době vlastní 9 států s jadernými zbraněmi téměř 15 000 bomb. Z nichž všechny jsou silnější než ta, která byla schozena na Hirošimu. Převážná většina jaderných zbraní je v rukou Spojených států a Ruské federace. 5 zemí hostí americké bomby na svém území a 28 dalších je zapojeno do jaderných aliancí. Většina zemí sice nemá jaderné zbraně ani nepatří k žádné vojenské alianci, sdílí však riziko konfrontace, i když k ní dojde daleko od jejich území.
This is what re-energized so many governments, particularly in the global south, to take this issue up again. The idea that nuclear weapons do not respect borders, that even a single detonation would affect everyone everywhere. Was something that was very significant to these countries that have security interests when it comes to nuclear weapons.
V rámci OSN navíc několik zemí spojilo své síly a úspěšně prosadilo zákazy různých typů zbraní, jako jsou protipěchotní miny a kazetové bomby. Tyto zákazy dosáhly úspěchu. Zastavili výrobu a použití těchto zbraní, a to i bez podpory jejich zákazů velkými mocnostmi.
Yeah, but no one's saying that chemical or biological weapons are okay for certain countries but not others, and no one's saying that it's okay to be sheltering under a chemical weapon umbrella or a biological weapon umbrella.
V roce 1980 vzniklo sdružení Mezinárodní lékaři pro prevenci jaderné války na základě etických úvah sdílených lékaři z obou bloků. A právě toto stejné sdružení o 26 let později odstartovalo mezinárodní kampaň za zrušení jaderných zbraní.
Basically, I think what drove all of us was this idea that nuclear weapons pose the greatest threat to public health in the history of the world, and that as physicians, we have a responsibility to address that problem, because all the things that we do for our patients in the course of our daily practice are going to be for naught if the world blows up in a nuclear war.
Kampaň vyzývá k jednání o komplexní, nezvratné, závazné a ověřitelné smlouvě, na které by se mohla dohodnout většina zemí. Od roku 2010 je kampaň zaměřena na humanitární katastrofu způsobenou jadernými zbraněmi oproti aspektům národní bezpečnosti, na které byl do té doby kladen hlavní důraz.
All of the states party to the non-proliferation treaty agreed by consensus that any use of nuclear weapons would have catastrophic humanitarian consequences, and nuclear weapons must be considered through the lens of international humanitarian law.
That really opened up space for an examination of the humanitarian effects of nuclear weapons once again.
And at the same time, there was also these joint statements at the UN. You know, 16 governments got together to acknowledge the catastrophic humanitarian consequences. Saying that any use of nuclear weapons would have this, and under no circumstances should nuclear weapons be used. And this was quite, you know, like a radical, but, you know, a sort of slowly, quite silently changing the narrative.
Tento nový přístup otevřel účast státům bez jaderných zbraní, akademické obci a občanské společnosti. V roce 2013 se v Oslu setkali diplomaté ze 128 států, aby studovali humanitární dopad jaderných zbraní. Následující rok diplomaté pokračovali v setkání v Novém Mexiku, vyzývajíce k bojkotu 5 stálých členů vlastnících jaderné zbraně. Pravidla hry se začala měnit.
It was the first time that you'd even organize something that the P5 didn't support. But we had the civil society forum, the ICAN civil society forum on the eve of this big conference, and we had the then State Secretary of Norway, Gry Larsen, and she talked about, in front of 600 ICAN people in the audience, talked about the boycott. Well, they've been very angry, the P5, they came and they demarched us and said, you know, this is a distraction. And she just sort of shrugged her shoulders and say, well, you know, their arguments weren't very convincing. And the whole audience laughed, and it was the first time we laughed at the P5. And, you know, it just clicked, like, oh my God, this is all about changing power dynamics, and this is all about controlling the narrative, and we're doing something, and they're on the outside.
Lots of new evidence was unveiled, and we heard very poignantly and prominently from the survivors, the Hibakusha, and also the nuclear test survivors.
Looking at the effects of an explosion, what this does to human bodies, what this does to cities, but also what it does to our economies and our way of life. Looking at the connections between the impacts and also the risks that we currently face, both in terms of intentional use of nuclear weapons, but also the risks from failures in command and control structures or accidental use of nuclear weapons.
Well, in Oslo, we presented evidence about our inability to provide an adequate humanitarian response in case of use of nuclear weapons.
No equipment exists to protect them from some of the radiation seeping through. Can you justify putting even more people at risk? Even if you get in, the number of victims is beyond anything you've ever seen.
I was in Nayarit, Mexico, at the second conference on that led to the treaty. And there was a moment in the afternoon on the last day that was amazing. 70 years, the nuclear armed states have told everyone else, we'll manage this, you stay home. Don't worry about this, we've got it. And I think it was at that moment that the rest of the world woke up and said, this will affect us. We have a right, we have an obligation to have our voices heard on this.
V roce 2014 na třetí konferenci v Rakousku podpořil kritický počet zemí takzvaný humanitární příslib, kterým se zavázali vyvinout úsilí ke stigmatizaci, zákazu a odstranění jaderných zbraní.
The conclusion was that there was a legal gap. There was no prohibition in place on nuclear weapons, and that was a problem. And Austria committed the pledged to work to fill the legal gap.
Zdálo se, že cesta k úspěchu smlouvy o nešíření jaderných zbraní se blíží ke konci, zatímco se otevírala cesta k úplnému zákazu jaderných zbraní. V roce 2016 byla v OSN zřízena otevřená pracovní skupina, která přinesla návrh zákazu.
It's a very complicated way to say we'll have a bunch of meetings where we're going to talk about what we can do to get rid of nuclear weapons.
We had pushed and we'd done all the work and we've been reaching out to governments and we've held regional meetings, we've been talking to parliamentarians, and we've been nagging for like 3 years. And at the opening of the working group, it was almost like you pulled out a plug and the support just came out from everyone.
And so by the end of this meeting in 2016, we had well over 100 countries going on the record saying that they wanted the General Assembly to negotiate a treaty to prohibit nuclear weapons.
That's the government side of what happened. But behind the scenes and in the streets and through creative actions, people have been pushing and pushing and pushing to make sure this happened. This wasn't just a couple of people in suits saying, oh, let's have some meetings.
Do roku 2017 získala smlouva velkou podporu. Vyjednávání byla vedena Elaine White Gomez z Kostariky.
De Costa Rica, que es un país que decidió desde hace 70 años tener un enfoque distinto hacia la paz y la seguridad aboliendo sus fuerzas armadas. Entonces, eso implica para un país como nosotros que nosotros pusimos toda nuestra confianza en un sistema internacional que a través de las reglas y de las instituciones podemos resolver los conflictos y los problemas de la humanidad.
In the course of the humanitarian initiative and the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, again, women have been instrumental. We had several women diplomats that were leaders for their countries. We had some all-women delegations also participating in the negotiations. We had women that were very active in the international campaign to abolish nuclear weapons.
Hay, digamos, dos enfoques cuando uno conversa sobre el tema de la participación de las mujeres. La primera de ellas, somos miembros de la humanidad, tenemos derecho de participar. También contribuimos desde la perspectiva de nuestra propia vivencia. Hay una contribución desde tener una perspectiva distinta que refuerce los procesos de negociación.
I don't believe that women are more peaceful than men, inherently. But I think that women play certain roles in society. If your main perspective is, you know, feeding people, providing healthcare to people, education to children. That's going to be your perspective on decision to go to war and use certain types of weapons.
Kromě toho byly vyslyšeny hlasy postižených lidských bytostí.
Each person had a name. Each person was loved by someone. Let us ensure that their deaths were not in vain.
Estamos hablando de seres humanos que en su experiencia humana, en esta vida, han conocido los horrores de lo que estamos tratando de solucionar. Eso le dio a la conferencia un espíritu de, un sentido de ética y de justicia que no habría sido posible si ellos no estuvieran allí.
Well, my job is to share my experience in Hiroshima and what it means to live in nuclear age, what horror that brings to humanity, and we should never ever let that happen again to another human being. That's my message, and I can't stop talking about it. I am going to keep talking.
V červenci téhož roku hlasovalo pro smlouvu o zákazu 122 zemí, tedy přibližně 2/3 z celkového počtu. Aby smlouva vstoupila v platnost, musí nyní proběhnout 50 ratifikací.
The treaty includes a broad range of prohibitions, a prohibition of course on the use of nuclear weapons as well as the threatened use of nuclear weapons. A prohibition on testing and production of nuclear weapons, and indeed a prohibition on the possession of nuclear weapons. It also says that a country cannot assist another country to engage in any of these kinds of activities.
But then it also demands that you help survivors of nuclear detonations and help to clean up the environment after detonation. And I think that that's really important language. It also has quite progressive language on gender, both encouraging participation of women in all decision making around nuclear weapons, and also recognizes the gendered impact of nuclear weapons.
I think we will move to a point where the taboo against nuclear weapons is as strong as the taboo against other weapons of mass destruction.
If this treaty was insignificant, if it didn't mean anything, why were they fighting it?
I also think it's really shown the power of civil society and governments working together. We stood up to some of the most powerful, most heavily militarized countries on this planet and did something that they were forbidding us to do.
The ability to kill massive amounts of people and inflict suffering and pain on civilians is not a sign of power and prestige. It's what dictators do. It's what human rights violators do, not respectable countries that want to have a good standing in the international community. And now it's their turn to be on the outside. They're going to have to justify why they want mass weapons of mass destruction, why they think threatening to mass murder civilians or end us all, collective suicide, is a reasonable security strategy.
Nobelova cena udělená Ikenu ještě více posílila a zviditelnila kampaň.
And the headlines were Nobel Peace Prize comes to effect a little bit, which is exactly what it was. And it's such a great thing because we get to celebrate as a campaign of 500 organizations in 100 countries. And
it's a huge validation for the work that those campaigners are doing in whatever context. And I think that's the most beautiful thing that I felt immediately afterwards. Just seeing our campaigners, these different, all across the world, get on TV, you know, take ownership of this amazing moment that had happened and really be elevated and validated for their hard work over the years.
Aby smlouva byla ratifikována v co největším počtu zemí, je nejdůležitější společenský tlak. Parlamentní slib, výzva měst, kampaně, zvyšování povědomí a mobilizace jsou nezbytné pro vytvoření zákazu a pokračujícího tlaku, dokud zákaz jaderných zbraní neskončí jejich úplným vymýcením.
ICAN also has what's called the Parliamentary Pledge, which is signed by over 800 parliamentarians across the world, and it's a pledge to work to bring the treaty into force in that country.
Parliamentarians are the representatives of the people, and they have a huge role to play in shifting government position.
Everyone can write to their senator or diputado, wherever they are, and get them to endorse the parliamentary pledge.
Y disponemos de una red de parlamentarios, tanto en el Congreso como en el Senado, en apoyo de la campaña y de las posiciones del ICAN, ¿no? En pro del Tratado de Prohibición de Armas Nucleares, y en estos momentos están 92 parlamentarios.
So the ICAN Cities Appeal is a commitment that cities can make to endorse the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons and call on their governments to join. Nuclear weapons are designed to be city destroyers, to have the maximum impact. To destroy as, you know, as many lives and as much infrastructure as possible.
Porque las bombas nucleares y los misiles están dirigidos a las ciudades, ¿no? Es una amenaza a la gente que vive en cada ciudad. Luego es misión del ayuntamiento que esté preocupado por luchar contra la violencia, defender a sus ciudadanos y a sus vecinos y vecinas frente a la amenaza nuclear.
We went to our city council to divest. We spoke to the finance chair of the council, and he said he would write a letter to the comptroller who controls all the investments for the pensions of the city, which billions of dollars, you know, if we could get 10 members of the council to sign on with him. I mean, I called my councilman and they told me he was on paternity leave. He had had his first child. So I wrote him a long letter saying, what a wonderful gift to your child to have a nuclear-free world if you would sign this letter, and he signed.
It only takes a few people to organize with city council. It only takes a few people to organize an event at your local library or a church or a school to have a conversation and to make a difference to policy, because all of this trickles up to policymaking.
Od roku 2012 se iniciativa Don't Bank on the Bomb snaží o to, aby bylo stále těžší financovat společnosti zapojené do výroby jaderných zbraní.
And what Don't Bank on the Bomb does is it gives everyone a pathway to resist nuclear weapons. People might not know this, but private companies make key components for nuclear weapons. And in order for them to be able to do that, they need financing from banks and pension funds. If you have a bank account, you can do something about nuclear weapons. You can talk to your bank and ask them, do they have a policy on investment? If you have a pension fund, is your pension fund profiting from the production of nuclear weapons? And if they are, why? You have a right as a consumer, you have power to do something, to change that. And people are.
I also learned that the stigmatizing effect goes beyond law, but it also can have economic impacts, which are extremely powerful when we're dealing with the production and sale of weapon systems.
Estados Unidos cerró su última fábrica de municiones en racimo sin haber nunca firmado la convención en contra de las municiones en racimo.
You know, the U.S. never signed the landmines treaty, but we don't make them anymore and we don't use them.
The decision to ban nuclear weapons will be a courageous one. It will change the world. There are billions of reasons why we need to ban nuclear weapons now. Each and every one of them has a name, a story, and a dream.
El tratado es una herramienta bastante potente, pero el desarme nuclear no va a llegar con la firma del tratado. Necesitamos de un movimiento global. Necesitamos que sea que la gente entienda. De generar conciencia a nivel de todo el mundo.
El primer punto de la primera marcha mundial fue tratar de luchar para conseguir que se erradicaran las armas nucleares, lo mismo que están erradicadas las químicas y las bacteriológicas.
Objetivo, volver a poner en la agenda la cuestión de la no violencia y la cuestión de acabar con las armas nucleares. La marcha lo que va es a recorrer durante varios meses un montón de países, dar la vuelta al mundo.
Zákaz jaderných zbraní je výzva, která spojuje národy po celém světě s cílem bránit lidi před velkými mocnostmi. Na obzoru za všemi hranicemi se již začíná vykreslovat všeobecný lidský národ. Svět bez válek, bez násilí, lidské bytosti žijící v souladu s životním prostředím, v souladu s právy vytvářející spravedlivý ekonomický systém. Bude to svět, který spojí rozmanitost etnik, jazyků a kultur do krásné mozaiky.
En historia humana estamos en permanente evolución y los cambios importantes no se dan de la noche a la mañana. Si las personas que estaban luchando por el fin de la esclavitud hubieran pensado que aprobando una ley o un tratado en un lugar muy específico no se iba a lograr, no tendríamos hoy lo que tenemos. Estamos en un proceso de transición y de cambio estructural. La comunidad internacional ya ha atravesado por esas etapas antes. Si nos vamos a la norma contra el colonialismo, se dio en momentos en que el colonialismo estaba en su máxima expresión.
We've seen throughout history that making change has been the result of people coming together collectively, whether that's been the civil rights movement or women's rights, right to vote, or ending slavery or ending apartheid. It's all been collective people's action that has changed the world.
I mean, just imagine how quickly the world has changed its mind on other things. Things like gay marriage, that was very controversial and unacceptable to many, and then very quickly, it just changed. And I think it can be the same thing with nuclear weapons. That it's just like, oh my God, remember when we did that? Remember when we had these like crazy suicide bombs? And like, we just thought that it was normal.
Jednoho dne bude jaderný věk uložen do naší paměti jako špatný sen, který se nám zdál v okamžiku strachu a zkázy. Znovu se nyní nacházíme na naší historické cestě. A právě v těchto temných okamžicích zmatení se znovu objevuje evoluční směr, který nás vede od úsvitu času. Uvědomujeme si, že život každého člověka je posvátný. A jaderné zbraně odmítáme, protože způsobují lidským bytostem nepopsatelné škody a utrpení.
But politics changes constantly. We're in a political climate right now that would have been totally unthinkable many years ago. And that doesn't only have to be negative. It can also be positive changes. It can also be quick changes in issues that we thought were intransigent for a long time. And nuclear weapons is part of that.
Working on nuclear disarmament is definitely a passion for me. It is my heart and soul, I think. Well, the whole project of abolishing war, of challenging violence. And it really comes from a place of believing that it is possible to change the world that we're living in.
Para mí lo que me motiva es la esperanza y que de que se puede hacer el cambio. Y la convicción de que hay que hacerlo, de que hay que hacer cosas, de que esto no está bien.
I'm really and constantly inspired by the people I get to work with. Because people who choose to spend their energy on nuclear weapons are not seeking fame and fortune. They're seeking to make the world better for themselves and for coming generations.
To have the opportunity to work with such talented and passionate people, to be part of a historic process that will have implications for the security and welfare of future generations is a great privilege and honor. And I couldn't think of anything else that I would prefer to be doing.
These weapons are not, they're not a force of nature, they're not an act of God. We have built these weapons, we know how to take them apart. And I think it's important for us all to understand, no one of us is going to do this by ourselves. But if each one of us does that part of the job which is ours to do, we can be successful again as we were in the 80s, and we can save the world again. And we can look ourselves in the mirror and say, hey, okay, I did what I was supposed to do.
We Hibakusha had been waiting for the ban for 72 years. Let this be the beginning of the end of nuclear weapons.
Mm-hmm.